So hello, everybody. Thank you for the introduction. So I'm Naomi. I'm a postdoc at Zang Lab and co-advised by Aviv Regev. And we should, something's happening. Just a second. See? Okay. Yeah, can start. Is this green thing okay? Okay. So what I'll tell you today is about the approach I've been developing for doing single nuclei RNA sequencing and how I use it to study the brain. So I think you'll all agree with me that our brain is amazing. And there are a lot of efforts being done to try to profile and understand dynamic processes in the brain, such as brain development, learning and memory, regeneration, and neurodegeneration. And the way I think about how to profile such dynamic processes in the brain is to try to understand the molecular dynamics underlying these processes in order to better understand the process and its regulation and the key regulatory checkpoints that we have. But there is actually a very big problem in trying to do molecular profiling in the brain. And the major challenge is that the brain is very heterogenic. So we have many different cell types, different types of neurons, and different types of glia cells that are different in their function, in their structure, and in their molecular readouts. And actually, in every single region within the brain, we have this mixture of different cell types all bound together. So in a traditional approaches, like bulk RNA sequencing, for example, where we take a piece of tissue and try to extract RNA from it, we get a very mixed signals. And this is even worse when we're trying to look at very rare cells that sometimes are crucial for the process we're looking at. So single cell RNA sequencing is actually very promising and exciting for many people in neuroscience. Because now what we can do is we can measure thousands of genes at the single cell level. And then in silico, afterwards, in the data analysis, we actually look at the profiles in each of the different cell types and subtypes separately. So now we can understand the contribution of each of the different cell types to the process we're interested in. But there's a very big challenge in trying to apply single-cell sequencing technologies to the brain. And the challenge comes from the complex cellular morphology of the brain. So the neurons, you already saw their structure, for example, that's already pretty clear that it's a complex cell, but we have a very dense and highly connected tissue. And in order to apply a single cell technology, the first step that we need is we need to get single cells. So what we need to do is we need to take this tissue and dissociate it into single cells, which means from when we're thinking about the neurons, it means we're actually taking only the neuronal cell body, which is already compromising the cell integrity in its RNA, and also during the dissociation process, we're actually harming the RNA. So, and it's even much worse when we're trying to look at adult or aging brain, which actually these dissociation will probably not be applicable at all. At least not in my hands, but I actually never met anybody who could do it for like an old aging mouse. So this was a very strong motivation for me to try and think of an alternative method. So what I'll tell you today is I'll tell you about my approach of how to apply single cell sequencing technology to the brain through single nuclei technology. And I'll first describe my application in characterizing the cellular diversity in the adult hippocampus, and I'll then move to one of the dynamic processes that interest me, which is brain regeneration, and tell you about the next method I've developed to address specifically brain regeneration, which is based on single nuclei sequencing. So let's start. So the idea behind the single nuclei approach is that if I just describe to you how harmful and problematic it is to dissociate single cells from the brain, actually, we can quite easily extract single nuclei from any tissue. This is a general approach. It's not specific to the brain. Without any need for enzymatic digestion, we're just using mechanical and gradient centrifugations in order to extract the nuclei, and we get a very clean and homogeneous output. You can see it here, some examples on the right on like typical nuclei that we would see in the microscope after extraction. And now what can we do? We can actually very easily do a protocol as Maromit described just now, like a SmartSeq2 protocol, which is a plate-based protocol where we fax sort our nuclei and then just do RNA sequencing in each of the individual wells of the plate using a SmartSeq 2 protocol. So we actually started with SmartSeq because that was what was available and very quickly upgraded into SmartSeq 2 and also did some modifications to that because it's actually a very high, it's an amazing protocol that gives us really high quality data. But when we just started, there were really many open questions that I hope that might also pop into your mind when you think about single nuclei sequencing that I hope to now address in the next few slides. So the first is it even technically feasible to take such a small amount of RNA in the nucleus and get a robust and high quality RNA-seq library? And the second is, what kind of information do we have from RNA in the nuclei and how informative it is to what we really want to do is understand the cell types and the cell states and look at dynamic processes. So the first answer is that yes, it works very nicely. This is true to the specifically to our protocol, which is a modified SmartSeq2 protocol, but we get very robust, high-quality libraries with around, for neurons, it will be around 5,000 genes that we detect per cell, that in the single-cell world, that's great. And it's also, we could apply it to animals of various ages. I tried it up to like two-year-old mice and now also in human tissue. And what's also very nice about the nuclei approach is we don't need to have only fresh tissue, we can only also use it on frozen or lightly fixed tissue. And this was now also shown by other groups that all published relatively recently, all showing that single nuclei approach is actually feasible. So let's continue. The next major question that kind of pops to mind is what kind of RNA do we have in the nuclei? So here is a bulk comparison between nuclei RNA and tissue RNA. And what you can see here is that we actually detect almost the same number of genes in the nuclei and in the cell. So this actually makes sense. Every RNA we're creating is Every RNA in the cell has to be transcribed, right? So we are expecting to find similar populations there and to be able to detect the same number of genes when we only look at the recently transcribed genes or in the cytoplasm. But more interestingly, it's not only that we detect a similar number, they're also the profiles are very highly correlated. So we see that the nuclear RNA not only don't only capture the same number of genes, but also the relative expression is similar. And finally, if we actually try to kind of drill in and find differentially expressed genes, we don't find that many genes. But what we do find is actually a quite strong enrichment for long non-coding RNAs that are known to be nuclear long. Some of them are known to be nuclear localized. So where it's actually expected to find some enrichment in these long non-coding RNAs. So this is on a bulk level. And the next question is, what kind of information do we actually have from a single nuclei regarding cell types and states? So I'll actually answer that by already addressing the first application, which is we wanted to understand the cellular diversity in the adult mouse hippocampus. So here you can see an image of the hippocampus, and it's traditionally segregated to four regions. We have the CA region, that's divided to three regions, and the dentigerous regions. And what we did is we just dissected each of the different regions out and did an unbiased analysis of the nuclei there. Didn't label specific cells. And what you can see here from, this is a similar clustering analysis where we do a principal component analysis, PCA followed by TSNE to embed into two dimension. And we can see that also with our single nuclei data, we can very easily identify different clusters, and each cluster represents the one of the known cell types in the hippocampus. So we have glia cells, we have the different neuronal, excitatory neuronal clusters, and we have an inhibitory neuronal cluster. You can see here on the right, the different excitatory neuronal clusters are actually separated to the different regions in the brain. So on the right, you have the, let's see, is this a thingy? Yeah. Here you can, I'm actually coloring this same clustering graph by the expression level of the gene. And next to it, you can see the in situ hybridization data for the same gene. So we can see here a cluster of glutamatergic neuron in the dentate gyrus region, in the CA1 region, in the CA3 region, for example. So this was actually already a very exciting step because we've seen that just by the RNA in the nucleus, we can already understand and classify these cells in an unbiased way. But we wanted to go much deeper into the data and try to see if can we now take a cluster of cells and go deeper and understand the different subtypes of cells that we have there and really explore what is the sensitivity of our data. So we started by taking each of these clusters separately and now going deeper and reclustering them. So we can look at the GABAergic neuronal cluster, for example, and what we usually get is we get this nice little blob of cells. So I'll do a little kind of 1 minute on computational aspects. This was a little disappointing at first that we weren't able to separate the cells that nicely to different subtypes. But when we looked at known markers that are associated with different subtypes of GABAergic clusters, what you can see very clearly is that the different cells that express the subtype markers are actually clustered closely together on this little blob of cells, right? So this led us to develop a nice, very simple algorithm, which the idea behind it is we start with our favorite clustering algorithm. It could be any clustering algorithm that embeds the data into two dimensions. We then score genes to genes that are informative and less informative. So an informative gene is defined as a gene that is expressed in a subset of cells, but also a subset of cells that are closely embedded in our first clustering. And we then use only the high-scoring genes to get a much better separation of our data. So this is just one example to how we can overcome the noisy nature of the single-cell data and also probably maybe also the biological nature of this data, because these cells are actually very closely associated with each other. So this, not being able to separate them could actually be biological. But having distinct clusters is very helpful for us in the analysis in later steps. So we're kind of sometimes forcing and sometimes just helping that data to reach more discrete populations. So here we can see kind of the final output where we find different GABAergic subtype populations, and we associated each one of them with a combination of known or GABAergic markers, which we were very happy about, and also showed us the strengths of the single nuclei approach that can really separate closely related cell types. So we did the same for many of the other cell types that we have. And I'll just show you one example. So for each of these subclusters, we tried to associate the subclusters with some biological meaning to test their meaning. So I'll show you one example in the CA1 and CA3 regions, which are, both of these subclustering are actually all pyramidal neurons. In the CA1, they're actually very similar to begin with. And we were able to find these nice separation between them. We then took spatial landmark genes from in situ hybridization data to map each of these transcriptionally distinct subclusters along the CA1 and CA3 regions in the hippocampus, showing that these subclusters are not only transcriptionally distinct, but they're also spatially separated. So what we're doing here is we're actually extending the kind of anatomical resolution of the mouse hippocampus. But I want to emphasize one thing here. Again, I kind of talked about it a little bit before. In this case, actually mapping these subclusters to the anatomical regions really emphasized that to us that these are not really distinct, discrete clusters, but rather a gradual transition in the transcriptional profiles. And this goes very nicely with a paper that came out recently, 2 hours, that showed that using different methods with population RNA sequencing and other methods. So what this is also important for the analysis. So when we're choosing an algorithm to analyze, we need to try to understand, are we trying to find discrete subpopulation of cells or rather gradual transitions between populations? Yes. How is this experimentally done? Yeah, I kind of skipped everything. Basically, what we do is we take landmark genes from in situ hybridization data, and that we know are, for example, localized specifically at the dorsal region of the CA1. So we have dozens of these marker genes, and now we can, based on the expression level of these marker genes in each of the clusters, we can give a score for each of this cluster to where is it positioned. And we see a very strong bias. For example, cluster 7 is strongly positioned here in this region based on that. So that's kind of on one foot, but actually it's published in our method, so yeah. So I'll end with one last example. Now we have these nice subtypes of cells, so we can start exploring genes that interest us. So I looked at the PenK neuropeptide, which is an opioid neuropeptide, also you might know it as enkephalin, and we can now look at it across all the different subtypes that we defined and try to see the expression pattern and see if it has a cell type or subtype specific expression. And indeed, PenK is specifically expressed in specific subclusters and very enriched in a subtype of GABAergic neurons. So I wanted to see, can we actually use this to start and understand better the enkephalin circuitry in the hippocampus? So we looked at the receptor for PenK. PenK is actually, enkephalin is secreted into, it's not like other neuropeptides. And we see that the receptor is also expressed in specific subtypes of cells. But not only that it is expressed in specific subtypes, it's always mutually exclusive expressed with the enkephalin neuropeptide. So we see this nice correlation between subtypes of cells that express the receptor and other subtypes that express the neuropeptide. So these are the type of fun games that we can do after we established our cell types and subtypes. We also validated this, of course, using RNA FISH data. So I'll quickly summarize the first part. We're running out of time. So what I showed you up to now, and I hope I convinced you, is that the single nuclei RNA-seq approach is actually a very strong approach when we want to study the brain. And we can simultaneously measure all the cell types. We're not biasing against cell types that are easier or harder to dissociate. And we can really use it to look at cell types and subtypes. And I showed you today how it helped us to reveal spatial and cell type specific expression patterns in the hippocampus. So now, so we actually addressed the first side, and now I'll go back to my motivation. I told you that we're interested in looking at dynamic processes in the brain. And the process I'm interested in is brain regeneration. So I think for many years, the belief was that the brain cannot regenerate. Right? But now, since the 90s, this was completely shifted when we discovered the neuronal stem cells and newborn neurons. So now we know actually a lot about the regeneration process in the brain. We know that there are neuronal stem cells that continue to proliferate and generate newborn neurons throughout the adult life. And this happens mainly in discrete regions within the brain, where these neuronal stem cells reside. But there's also a lot of evidence for neurogenesis outside of these regions that is actually still an ongoing question. And here's one of the major neurogenic regions in the mouse and in the human brain is actually within the dentate gyrus region within the hippocampus, the same region we were just discussing. And here you can see newborn neurons, Martin GFP. And what we know is that these neurons are important for specific tasks of learning and memory, and also when the process is not working correctly, it's associated with many different diseases like depression and Alzheimer's. So I had a lot of motivation to better understand this process, and I asked very specific questions regarding these. The first one, I wanted to get a detailed molecular profiling of the neurogenesis process, and specifically also of the neuronal maturation, which I felt was missing and really holds back our understanding of the regulation of the process. And the second one is actually try to understand better where does neurogenesis exist outside of the region. So we already discussed some of the challenges in using single-cell RNA-seq technology in the brain, but this is actually more challenging since we're discussing about a rare population of neurons and a continuous process. So let's go, when we want to address a question like looking at adult neurogenesis, what are the challenges that we're facing? So the first challenge is that we need to dissociate the cells into single cells. But now we already have a tool to address that using our SNUC-seq method, or single nuclear RNA-seq. The second problem is where we want to fish out these rare cell newborn cells out of the rest. But actually, as I told you before, we're already fact sorting our nuclei, so this is actually pretty easily integrated into the SNUC-seq technology. And the problem we're left with is how to actually specifically label these cells so we can fact sort them. So the problem is that we're lacking specific genetic markers that can really mark the entire process or each step of the process. So I used an alternative idea, and that was to build on the SNUC-seq technology, but to add labeling of dividing cells using EDU. So EDU incorporates into the DNA of dividing cells, and then after we extract the nuclei, we can fluorescently tag only the EDU labeled cell, and then we can fact sort them and do SmartSeq2 as we did before. So this is a very powerful method, and since we're actually unbiasedly labeling any dividing cell, we're actually asking who are the cells that are dividing. We don't need any genetic markers. But more than that, if we're thinking about a dynamic process, we're actually doing pulse labeling. So we're labeling the neurons or the dividing cells as they're dividing. So we're actually labeling the stem cells and the progenitor cells while they're dividing. And we can then decide how much time we're waiting until we're extracting the tissue. And this will give us a handle to capture the different stages of the neurogenesis. So with a short time point, we're going to capture the progenitor cells. With a long time point, we're going to capture the immature neurons, etc. So this is indeed what we did. And what I used this for is I first used it to look at the adult neurogenesis in the hippocampus, which is a well-established neurogenic region. And as you can see here in the first kind of QC, is that after 2 weeks, most of the cells that we capture express all the markers of immature neurons. We also get a nice portion of cells that are oligodendrocyte precursor cells, which are also dividing cells. So what we did next is I did this nice dense time course of EDU labeling to really capture the cells along all the entire process. We can see that, for example, at 2 days and 14 days, we capture cells that express different markers of neuronal precursors and neuroblasts or immature neurons depending on the day. So we're really capturing this diverse population. However, at each of these stages, as you can see here, we capture a very diverse population. Right, so actually, a population analysis doesn't fit us, but luckily we did single cell analysis, so we can go back to the same approach of using a clustering method to try and align these neurons along the trajectory. And actually, we didn't have to go very far. We actually used the same method, and the neurons almost naturally aligned onto this trajectory. And we can hear the neurons are colored based on the day of dissociation, and you can see that we really captured the early cells in the beginning and the later cells at the end. We can also see another validation that this is a maturation trajectory looking at known marker genes. So we can see that the expression of the marker genes along the trajectory really follows what we would expect based on the known stages. So what can we do once we have this kind of trajectories? And this is a type of analysis. There are many algorithms actually developed to capture trajectories that we didn't even apply here. But once we have the trajectory, now we have a very strong, powerful tool in our hand, right? Now we have the neurons all aligned together, and now we can ask ourselves and unbiasedly search to what are all the genes that are dynamically changing along this process. So this is indeed what we did, and I actually used the same Bias-NE algorithm I described to you before to find these genes that are dynamically changing along the process. And here's a clustering result that you can see, or not very well see, maybe, that what we find is we find these very nice coordinated transcriptional switches of hundreds of genes that are coordinately going up and down along the maturation and the differentiation and maturation process. So this is a very, it was very nice to see that we have these very strong transcriptional checkpoints that change the transcriptional changes. And now we can associate each of these signatures with pathways that are changing along this trajectory. And I'll just show one example that I find specifically interesting, where we looked and we found genes that are related to immune response and specifically interferon signaling. And now we can see exactly like who are these genes and where at which stage they're expressed along this trajectory, which really shows the involvement of the immune signaling in the neurogenesis process. So this is one example. There's more data in our paper here. I'll just jump to the last question, kind of end with that. So now we have this actually a nice tool to try and search for neurogenesis outside of the neurogenic niches. So the problem with looking outside of the neurogenic niches is we are expecting to see much rarer cells, and they're not very well localized. So trying to use like imaging approaches is very challenging, but with a DeepSeq, we can actually try to approach this. So the first, what I'll show you today is evidence of neurogenesis in the spinal cord, which was like a debate before in the literature if neurogenesis actually exists there. So what we found when we applied DeepSeq, we found that indeed in our EDU labeled fraction, we see, first of all, many dividing cells. Most of them are oligodendrocyte precursor cells, which goes nicely with what other people have shown in the literature. But we did find a nice little fraction of genes that are specifically neuronal. And we look specifically at marker genes, we see that these are a specific subtypes of neuron that is being created, which are GABAergic neuron, inhibitory neurons, which are different from actually the neurons we profiled in the hippocampus. I did a similar analysis looking, trying to track the dynamics of the process also in the spinal cord, and then compared it to the dynamics in the dentate gyrus, finding many genes that are commonly dynamically expressed across these different processes, which are inherently different because we're generating a different neuronal subtype here in a different region and in a non-canonical region. Neurogenesis. We also find, of course, many differences that I'll leave for a later talk, and I'll just kind of summarize here quickly what I showed you up to now, or today in general. That's the end. Don't want to scare you. So what I showed you today is I actually presented to you two different methods, a SNUC-seq method, or single nuclei RNA-seq approach, and the DeepSeq method that builds on the single nuclei RNA-seq approach that specifically profiles dividing cells. And I hope I convinced you that really using the RNA information from the nuclei could be very informative. I showed you how I use it to find cell type specific and spatial transcription patterns in the hippocampus and learn about the cellular diversity in the hippocampus, and also how we can really identify dynamic transitions in cell state. When we look with the DeepSeq method, we were able to find RNA and pathway dynamics of adult neurogenesis, and also to do a more exploratory analysis and find rare newborn neurons in the spinal cord, which we are, of course, very excited about, and about the therapeutic applications of this. But just a general word about the methods themselves. So there's actually wide applications for SNUC-seq and DIV-seq well beyond the brain. So it actually can be applied to any complex tissue where cell dissociation is an issue. Or for example, even if the cell dissociation is relatively simple, but we want to look at transcriptional changes that are very that happen very rapidly, the cell dissociation itself might be actually problematic. We might want to first fix the cells and then do the single cell RNA-seq technology. So in that case, the nuclear approach actually can come in. And one other reason that why this is actually very exciting to many people in various communities, like the cancer community, is the option to take a frozen tissue. So we have a lot of tissues that we want to ship for far away, or all the for me, it's like the huge brain banks that we have of tissues, that now I can actually start taking them and looking at them and exploring them with a nuclei approach. Two other kind of nice points is, one is I showed you how with DeepSeq I actually use an internuclear, I'm labeling an internuclear marker, right? I'm labeling a marker that sits on the DNA. So similar, this is also, and I didn't need to fix my cells and then do reverse cross-linking or something like that. And so this could be also a nice approach if we want to look at transcription factors, for example, to label our cells. And of course, if we want to characterize using pulse labeling of dividing cells, DIV-seq is also a nice approach. So I just have to end by saying thank you to many, many important people who are crucial for this work. So first of all, Fang and Aviv are really amazing to work with. Ying-Ching Li, a grad student that I worked very closely in the lab, and he's a co-author on the paper. He was also very important for the development of the BIAS-NE, the bi-clustering algorithm I showed you today, for example. Lukas and Matthias in the Zhang lab were two amazing neuroscientists who've been instrumental from the first steps of the project. Inbal and Cindy, who helped us to, and John, who helped us to push through all the million revisions, and many other important people in the Regev lab and the Zhang lab that were helpful along the way. Thank you.
Neurons, yeah. As well. And so, have there any? Do you know? I don't know. I haven't read all of the papers. That other cell types that have been studied. Does it not work for any particular cell type, or has that same formula?
The nuclei, you mean?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't think anything was published yet. So I know a lot of collaborators have been doing it for many different cell types, and it seemed to be working very robustly. For example, some types of cancers that weren't able to dissociate, the nuclear approach worked immediately. Other epithelial cells, I don't know, muscle cells. It seemed to be quite robust. Of course, as I think also was mentioned in the previous talk, it's very important to optimize the specific parameters to the method. So for example, also within the brain, there's a huge difference between the neurons and the glia cells. The glia cells have much less genes expressed, so it's harder to sequence them. It's working very nicely, but you might, if you're aiming for a cell type that has less RNA, you might need to kind of optimize a bit more, or just increase your PCR cycles or something like that. But generally, I mean, the nuclei isolation protocol is pretty robust, and this protocol itself seemed to be quite easy, so that's why I like it. Yeah.
So you showed that you have very nice correlation between the nuclei approach and the whole cell approach in terms of the number of genes detected.
Right.
In terms of the quantity of each gene, do you see also a good correlation between
The relative level or the, not the absolute quantity, of course, right, yeah. So the relative levels are highly correlated on the bulk tissue. When we go down to the, so actually I only did the comparison on nuclei and cells in a single cell level in only in neurons, which we know is problematic because of the dissociation. So there, of course, we start to see more differences. And it's hard to say if the differences come from the dissociation only or from the nuclear approach, but generally they're always correlated. And what more than that, we can always find, for example, in a clustering analysis, the same cell types or even more cell types using the nuclear approach, because I think the data is actually cleaner in the way that we don't get a lot of cross-contamination between the dissociated cells. So it could also be, but this is just my hypothesis, that actually the recently transcribed genes are actually very useful information when we're trying to think of like classifying the cells. So it could also be a reason.
Yeah.